My name is Wolfram Rollet, and I'm the chair of this keynote session. And on behalf of Early and SIG 18 Educational Effectiveness, I'm honored, I'm very honored to introduce to you our distinguished keynote speaker, Professor Eckhard Klime. Eckhard Klime is a professor of educational science and director of the Center of Research on Educational Quality and Evaluation at the Leibniz Institute for Research and Information in Education, well known as DIPF internationally. On an international level, he is responsible for questionnaire development in PISA and in the ongoing TALIS video study. Within Germany, he directed a famous national study of language education, several very important large-scale school evaluation projects, and well-known video-based classroom studies. His recent outstanding research is mostly dealing with foundations for teaching effectiveness, including concept of teaching quality, mediators and moderators of teaching effects, and the role of culture. We are very happy that you accepted the invitation to give a keynote lecture, and we are excited to hear your inspiring perspectives on teaching quality and effectiveness. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thanks a lot to Wolfram and the committee who invited me. I'm pleased to take you on a journey today across like 20 years of research on teaching. The seven seas we are going to sail are the seven major studies on teaching that I was happy to work on as one of the principal researchers, principal investigators. There were a lot of people working on these studies, and I'm indebted to all of them. I'm more than happy that I had the opportunity to start this work like 20 years ago at the Max Planck Institute, when I was actually the project coordinator for the German enhancement to the TIMSS video study, and later on, based in Frankfurt, we ran another six studies, and I'm really very, very grateful for all the people who have been working with me, and there are more than you can see here. Most of the papers actually have been written by the project coordinators and by the doctoral students. That's why I will cite a lot of papers from other people where I'm just the co-author. In terms of design and the content addressed, most of these studies have been doing with mathematics, some also in science. All of them have involved a pre-post-test design with multiple classrooms. Most of them, with the exception of a German add-on to PISA 2012, involved video shootings, and some, and this is a very specific character of my work, some of them have been focusing on specific topics and even trained teachers. So if we order or reorder this list by design, you will immediately realize that this is a kind of example for what Rosenshine and Furst have called the observational correlational experimental loop, although we haven't gone through many loops yet, and hopefully we don't need these loops, but I think it was worthwhile starting with observational studies, more or less moving from correlational to experimental studies. And by the way, the kind of experimental study that we did, both with the so-called COCA project and the EAGLE project, also have a long tradition in education research. To my knowledge, the first time ever that people did single-topic experimental variation systematically on the classroom level was a research program started by Graham Nuthall in New Zealand like 50 years ago. The nice thing with this change of design is that you would expect an increase in internal validity for understanding relationships between teaching and student learning, but at the same time, of course, there may be a decrease in external validity of these studies. The more they are focused on a certain topic and the more the teachers are trained and even asked to use some kind of scripted instruction, which actually we did in the Eagle and the Coca studies. So there's pros and cons with regard to this chain of designs, and I will let you know more about these. The talk will be divided into four sections. I will start with a prologue referring to the TIMSS video, German Enhancement in 1995, because at that study already the core idea of research on teaching that deals with the content matter, the practices and the quality has been developed. I will then move on with some theoretical ideas on the concept of teaching quality that came up from the TIMSS video study, which is now known as the TBD or three basic dimensions model. But I will try to move beyond this model in my talk, especially with regard to my theoretical argumentation. I will then spend some time showing very quickly, but in a comprehensive way, the kind of research and empirical studies that can be done in such a topic focused design, and using I will do this using the Eagle study, which we implemented in Frankfurt some years ago, and we are still producing new publications on. I will then briefly add some findings on content matter and how it matters in teaching based on a German enhancement to the PISA study, and I will finally present some new, very recent results combining the ongoing Leibniz video study with the old data from TIMSS, looking into change of instructional cultures across 23 years in Germany. Okay, let's start with TIMSS. As you will know for sure, or most of you will know, TIMSS video was a three-country study on grade 8 mathematics teaching using representative samples from the US, Japan, and Germany. They shot one lesson from each classroom. In the US and in Japan, there was no testing design, no pre-post tests and questionnaires, but in Germany, the design was enhanced by Jürgen Baumert and colleagues to establish a full-size, longitudinal, multi-level study on classroom teaching effects. One of the interesting findings on an international comparative level was the fact that content differed a lot. Some mathematics educators were asked by Jim Stiegler to judge the quality of the content, and as you can see here, most of the content in the US classrooms was rated as low, whereas Japan had a higher number of medium or even high quality content, and Germany was somewhere in between. Let's look at an example, and this is actually an example from a classroom which is one of the higher positive examples of demanding content from the German sample. And the interesting thing is it is one of out of six classrooms within that study that used some kind of proving. So let's see how this teacher does a mathematical proof with his class.
Und was entsteht jetzt? Durch dieses simples Verbinden von Linien. Aus einem Viereck entsteht Miriam vier Dreiecke. Richtig. Welche Eigenschaft haben diese vier Dreiecke, Philipp? Wir haben eine besondere Eigenschaft. Nein, sie sind nicht kongruent. Dann müsste ja die Seite genauso lang sein wie die.
Und MC und MC.
wie gesagt, bilden einen gleichständigen Kreis. Nein, welcher Satz bildet einen gleichständigen Kreis? Dort und die Basis wird gesunken. Sehr gut. Die Zeichen nehmen wir mal ein. Und jetzt wieder abpassen.
Okay, so this was an example of what I called at that time the base angle procedure or routine, because it turned out that out of the six classes that we saw who implemented some kind of proof, always within the context of geometry, everybody, every teacher used this routine. That is, they used this base angle theorem within a more complex kind of geometrical graph, and students were asked, what do you see? Students then sometimes provided wrong answers, and others were called upon to provide alternatives. Students identified these angles correctly, provided the information that these angles would be equal, and applying the well-known base angle theorem, and this would be an important step within proving some kind of mathematical theorem. So that's a rather complicated kind of mathematical argument, and it was implemented in those classrooms. That's an indicator of ability of German mathematics teachers at that time to implement high kind of quality in geometry, but at the same time, what they did was all very teacher-directed, and the students only provided bits and pieces of the information. And this is typical also for the kind of practices that we saw at that time. As you can see here, Germany was the country within those three that had the lowest percentage of seat work within classrooms, and even within seat works, there was very, very little group work. And one outstanding feature of Japanese instruction at that time, the Japanese teachers were using group work, small group work, systematically. Last but not least, on top of the content matter and the practices, Tim's video 1995 in Germany also looked at what we call teaching quality. And the approach was rather innovative. It was driven by a dissertation that was later published by Martin Clausen. Martin collected all kinds of indicators for teaching quality, working with constructs from the process product paradigm, but also constructs from classroom climate research, from traditional subject matter didactics, etc. So he came up with a list of altogether 22 constructs that had been implemented before, mainly through questionnaires. And Martin turned these questionnaires into high inference rating scales that were applied by trained raters to judge the quality of mathematics instruction in those classrooms. And when we later did a factor analysis of these factors, it turned out that of these scales, it turned out that they could be nicely described by three factors, which we called structure and classroom management, supportive climate, and cognitive activation. And finally, this is last slide on Tim's. One of the nice results was that there seems to be a relationship between these factors. They are not independent. On the contrary, as you can see here, a high level of, or at least a reasonable level of structure and classroom management seems to be a prerequisite for high level of cognitive activation. What you also see here is that our classes, where we saw some kind of geometrical proof, are at the upper end of both dimensions. So these classes where teachers were able to implement a proof were both high on classroom management and on cognitive activation. And we at that time, we predicted that both classroom management and cognitive activation would drive student learning. What we did not ask ourselves is whether this prediction, which could to some extent be shown at that time, may be driven by the content. So the if you look at this picture, at this graph, clearly the question comes up whether what makes these classrooms that combine high classroom activation and high classroom management successful is these basic dimensions, or whether it's the kind of content, in this case the proving and the practice of very tight argumentation, discourse involving teachers and students, whether these are the relevant factors. In fact, in the years following the TIMSS video exercise, the research at Max Planck, at DIPF, and at many places in Germany very much focused on these three, what we now call basic dimensions of teaching quality. We were able to add some theoretical foundations to that based on the theory of schooling, which tells us that any instruction needs to ensure three basic functions of teaching, while at the same time assuming that the students already come in with a certain level of these dispositions. The dispositions are attentiveness, being attentive, being on task, being motivated, and being cognitively activated in order to understand the topic and build up individual cognitive representations. Well, and the basic idea was that the three dimensions we have seen in high inference ratings on teaching processes more or less represent the conditions of classroom teaching that help teachers and students to ensure these three basic functions to be implemented and ensured to a reasonable level. And also, in order to understand how these three dimensions work in order to drive student learning and student motivation, we applied different kinds of psychological theories. We finally came up with a model which is both a structural model, claiming that these three dimensions to a larger extent can explain or can describe the structure of things we see in classroom teaching, at least when applying this kind of high inference rating. And this structural model is combined with a mediation model, which means a process model that has some hypotheses in it on which mediating psychological processes are relevant for linking the teaching quality to student learning, both with regard to knowledge and understanding and with regard to motivation and other effective outcomes. There are a lot of similarities. I do not claim that our model is in fact the same. It's identical with other models. All the operationalizations and the theoretical conceptions do have some differences, but by and large, there's quite a close analogy between the TBD model and the class system developed by Pianta and Hamre, who talk about classroom organization, emotional support, instructional support. And as I showed on this slide, a lot of other observation protocols which have been used widely in research on teaching to some extent represent these three basic dimensions. Even with regard to the mediation model, there's a close similarity to a model that has been published in the most recent edition of the Handbook of Research on Teaching by Capella and others, who also claim that there are three clusters of classroom teaching practices, which they base on the work by Pianta and Hamre. They have mediating factors, as we do, including metacognition, self-regulation, student engagement, and then they have both cognitive and non-cognitive student outcomes. So this kind of mediation model is used not only in Germany. In Germany, we have this famous metaphor of opportunities and use, which was developed by Helmut Fendt and Andreas Helmke, but the same model, without any citation of the German language work, by the way, is used by US authors as well. Up to now, the TBD model has been explicitly used by at least 21 independent studies. That was the state of the art about a year ago. I think, meanwhile, there are even more of these studies. Anna Pretorius has done a very good job in reviewing these studies. I will not go into these details. This has been published last year in ZEM Mathematics Education. What I want to stress is that, to my understanding, of course, three dimensions are not enough to cover what is relevant in teaching. And one way to acknowledge the multiplicity of relevant aspects of teaching is to look at empirical findings that speak to the specificity of different kinds of aspects. And this was done already with the data from our so-called Pythagoras study. For example, with Katrin Rakoczy as the first author, like 10 years ago, we published a paper where we showed that what could be called structure as one of the three dimensions actually needs to be disentangled. So there's one aspect to these structuring processes or structuring qualities that refers to behavioral classroom management, and there's another aspect that refers to the structure and quality of the content. Likewise, in her dissertation on Pythagoras data, Katrin Rakoczy showed that supportive quality could be split up into socio-emotional support on one hand and adaptive, individualized content-related instruction on the other hand. And last but not least, Barbara Drollinger-Vetter from Zurich and Frank Lipowski in 2006 already developed additional indicators on what they called content quality, and they are still publishing on this based on Pythagoras data, showing there's also a need to disentangle more generic aspects of cognitive activation and more content-specific aspects. So right now I'm talking about six dimensions, and this is better aligned with the famous dynamic model of educational effectiveness developed by Bert Kremers and Leonidas Kyriakides last year. This is from a joint presentation I gave with Leonidas Kyriakides. We came up with this link between our frameworks, and the interesting feature, however, is that socio-emotional support is not included in the dynamic model because they are very much focused on the cognitive learning within teaching. And last but not least, these six aspects or dimensions of teaching quality are also taking up somehow, once again, there's a difference in exact definition of constructs, there's a difference in operationalization, but the basic ideas are similar. It's also used in the framework that Courtney Bell and others have been using in the ongoing Thales video study. This has been presented 2 days ago on Monday in a symposium on Thales video, where no data have been shown. I also am not able to show any data from this study, but it is important to realize that these six dimensions, to some extent, this is a rough picture, also match onto the framework I presented earlier. So we could use these six dimensions to have a closer look into quality of teaching, and this is what I will actually do at the end of my talk when revisiting the TIMSS video data. One important thing I learned when discussing with the colleagues from the US is the notion they were using more often than teaching quality was teaching practices. So when you listen to Courtney Bell telling about these six dimensions or domains, as she calls them, she would talk about teaching practices. And it caused a lot of difficulty for me to understand what they were meaning, referring to, and we had a lot of debate. So still, it's an open question for me. What do the colleagues in the US mean? What do they refer to when they talk about practices? Here's one list of so-called effective teaching practices that was presented by Valberg and Paik in the early 2000s. And when you look at this list of 10 so-called practices, at least three of them are what Nicholas Gage called intact patterns. So these are not individual practices, but these are sets or clusters of behaviors that have been promoted by somebody as a useful or important or effective kind of teaching, something like direct teaching or mastery teaching. This is not an individual practice, it's a set of practice. Sometimes it's a brand name or an ideology that is sold to teachers. There are also out-of-classroom practices, which I would not count as practices within teaching. And there is one aspect of curriculum coverage. And finally, there are some instances of what Nicholas Gage called discrete teaching practices. So this is practice in a more narrow, pragmatic sense, and I would accept these as practices. Similarly, Deborah Ball, in her very well-known work on so-called high-leverage teaching practices, actually includes a lot of professional activities beyond the classroom. She addresses or includes some what I would call generic functions of teaching, which are very close to our three basic dimensions. And in fact, these four nicely match on the three dimensions. Finally, she in fact has, once again, some discrete teaching practices like small group work or diagnosing and questioning, which are discrete teaching practices in a more narrow sense. So I think the notion of practice is quite fuzzy in the US literature, and even if you look at the recent handbook of research on teaching, it's quite difficult to find any specific definition or explanation of what a practice is all about, although the word is abundant. And my understanding is this is related to what in earlier times, in the earlier editions of the handbook, for example, people would have called teaching methods, or as Rosenshein and Furst put it, teaching skills. For Rosenshein and Furst, it was important that on top of what they referred to as a classroom-focused approach and research that looks into the quality aspects of teaching, explaining student learning, and also on top of the content-related aspects of teaching, which they were aware of very well, they said that especially for teachers, in order to train teachers and to communicate to teachers, what research need to come up is with some kind of tools for trade, and these are exactly the discrete practices or the teaching methods. Now, when looking at the single chapter in the handbook of research on teaching in 2016 that actually comes up with a definition of practices, the interesting thing to notice is that they are using a very, very different tradition of theorizing on practice, namely a tradition that comes from sociology, especially from so-called practice theory. Reckwitz, 2002, is the most important citation here. And this is something that most of us who are doing quantitative work on teaching even don't know. our colleagues who do qualitative work on teaching, they actually use this notion of practice. And from this perspective, it's clear that teaching practices refer to some essential activities that members of a field or of a profession are socialized into as part of the professional training. And one of the most important challenges for the future of theorizing on teaching, to my understanding, is that we should be able to revisit our knowledge of teaching tools, teaching methods, discrete practices, however you call them, and align them with a practice theory perspective, because I think the practice theory perspective explains, for example, why these tools or practices are so stable, why they are applied again and again in everyday teaching. And in order to understand teaching from a professional perspective, I think it would be very helpful to take up this practice theory perspective, also to align our work in quantitative research with the qualitative research. Also, that might help to overcome a tendency that is still visible in research on teaching and teacher education, that is, instead of researching on practices and quality and content, people continue to promote what Nuthall and Snook called models. This is a different notion of model than our current notion of model, or intact patterns such as discovery learning, direct instruction, or personalized learning. And I think other challenges for theory of teaching are developing measures of content or implemented curriculum and to integrate them into models of teaching effectiveness, and also developing and testing models of teaching quality, like the ones I've shown before, that integrate structural and process or mediation aspects. And one nice example of how to develop theory to bridge instruction and learning is the paper on basic models of teaching by Osa and Beresville, which we to some extent also take up in current work on the TBD model. Maybe more relevant for the practical work of doing empirical research on teaching is this list of research questions. I think it is important for anybody who is doing a major study on teaching effectiveness that covers a broader aspect of dimensions, a broader range of dimensions, is that the research needs to cover practice, quality, and content. So one of the first research questions is, which are the practices, tools, methods, however you call them, which hold high potential based on existing literature, identify them and use them in research. Second challenge, and also that comes along with a number of research questions, is how to measure the practices, but also quality and content, and also how to come up with instructionally sensitive measurement of dispositions and outcomes, because a lot of research on teaching has been challenged by non-instructionally valid tests, and so we end up with low or zero effects just because our tests are not aligned with the curriculum and the content covered. Then research would go on to study effects of practices, including differential effects, effects of quality, interaction between practice and quality, and then moving to the mediation side or the use side of the model, measuring and understanding use of opportunities by individual students and the mediation by psychological processes. So this is a long program for empirical research, and actually this program has been implemented in the Eagle study, which I'm now going to talk about. Eagle was the largest project, and still is the largest project, within a center that has been founded like 10 years ago in Frankfurt at the DIPF, at my institute, in collaboration with Goethe University and also with the Sigmund Freud Institute. Within this idea center, EAGLE was a study on adaptive education, and there Jasmin Dekristan, who is the first author on many of the papers, has been the project coordinator. The group of principal investigators includes a number of well-known experts like Ilonka Hadi, Mareike Kunter, Gerd Büttner, who is an expert in metacognition, Armin Lüken, a science education expert, etc. And we had a larger group of doctoral students who at this moment are, most of them are already senior researchers and professors. What did we do? The goal was within the center, because it's a center on individual development and adaptive education, the goal was to study adaptive education, whatever this means. And we came up with a conclusion we would not add another study on some kind of intake pattern, like trying direct instruction with low-achieving children, something like that. But we would start with one of these intact patterns that is well-known and has been proven to be relevant and effective by research, and then add on specific discrete teaching practices to this underlying pattern. So the overall pattern we implemented in that study was the pattern of inquiry-based science education, in this case, as implemented in primary school, related to the content of floating and sinking. And this has been the result of a rather famous, important study that was conducted at Max Planck Institute in Berlin in collaboration with the University of Münster, Cornelia Möller, Elsbeth Stern, Ilonka Hadi, who developed this approach to inquiry-based science education, developing materials that can be used by teachers, etc. So we took this for granted, and we started on top of this intact pattern of teaching to add discrete practices, in this case, practices that have been supposed or suggested in the literature as being able to adapt teaching to the diversity of student needs within a classroom. One example is a formative assessment practice, which was implemented in a very easy way by supplying very brief kind of diagnostic tests that nevertheless allowed the teacher to identify the misconceptions that student had on floating and thinking, and in the next lesson ask them to implement certain kinds of experiments within this inquiry-based science education program, experiments that would help them to overcome their misconceptions. So that's a kind of adaptivity driven by formative assessment in the classroom, formative assessment of the state of conceptual knowledge and the state of misconceptions, then driving teacher recommendations for further individual and group-based learning in experimentation. The two other practices implemented here were scaffolding and peer learning. Scaffolding, to tell you this in advance, may be the practice of adaptive teaching that is most famous, especially, of course, among people who subscribe to the social constructivist theory of teaching. And it has been shown to be very relevant and very effective in a number of studies. The problem in our design, as we learned later on, was that actually the basic treatment that all the students experienced was already very close to the idea of scaffolding, because it was developed by Möller, Hardy, Stern and others as more or less as an implementation of scaffolding. So adding scaffolding as an extra practice by training teachers to lead classroom discourse on student misconceptions, etc., was perhaps not adding enough value to the basic treatment. So I already explained the basic design, I think. So there was a randomization process. 54 classrooms participated in this study. The teachers were randomly assigned to the three conditions of so-called or expectedly adaptive teaching practices, and the fourth group received a training on how to work with parents. So something that we thought would be unrelated to the teaching of floating and thinking. Nevertheless, all the teachers received a training on floating and thinking, so we made sure that all the teachers understood the material, understood the didactical concept of inquiry-based teaching in this area. They overtrained on the physics and chemical aspects of floating and thinking, etc. And then the specific there was a specific training on these edit practices, and we had two periods of implementation in classroom. In between, there was a kind of rehearsal with the teacher, and of course, a number of measurement points, including video video taking, questionnaires, tests, etc. Now, I will very quickly walk you through what we found, ordered by the sequence of research questions that I raised before, because in effect I believe that Eagle is a very nice example of how one study can actually cover a lot of these research questions, moving from the very simple question of effectiveness of main effects of a treatment up to very sophisticated questions on differential effects, mediation processes, etc. But before we can start to study any effect or estimate effect sizes, we have to make sure that our instruments work well and our treatments work well. So one of the some of the first papers that have been written are papers that developed and implemented implementation checks for all three interventions, and of course only classrooms that had reasonable value on these implementation check scales could be included in the analysis. Then a core element is the measurement of teaching quality. The three basic dimension models was applied here, and the nice aspect of the study is that Benjamin Faud was able, of course, supported by the whole team, was able to come up with an operationalization of the three dimensions in student questionnaires for very young students in primary schools in grade three. The way the items on these questionnaires were phrased obviously allows students in grade three to make valid statements on what they see in the classroom, so all three dimensions are covered. And in a paper that was published in Learning Instruction, also as one of our first papers in 2014, Benjamin was able to show that a multi-level model discriminating the three dimensions, both on the individual and the classroom level, fit the data very well. In addition, we implemented teacher questionnaires also on the three dimensions, and we had observers and video raters. In some classrooms, we were not allowed to take videos. That's where we sent in observers doing live observations, and later we combined the data. So we also had observational data, and it turned out, and this is one of the rare studies where you can really check the importance of individual perspectives and the relationship between student perspective, teacher perspective, and observer perspective. And the interesting result was that for cognitive activation, none of the correlations between the perspectives was significant, whereas for classroom management, all of them were highly correlated. So classroom management is where we have high agreement between the perspectives, and cognitive activation is the opposite. And also, another nice example, nice finding was that for supportive climate, we found that from the perspective of teachers and students, this cannot be disentangled from cognitive activation. So if you ask at least three great students, but also their teachers, they obviously emotional support and cognitive activation is not, at least in Germany, in German primary schools, cannot easily be disentangled. I tend to believe that this is a problem of our primary schools, teachers, and classrooms, but nevertheless, that's a finding. And of course, we had to make sure that our tests, especially the tests on floating and sinking, are instructionally sensitive, and there's still ongoing work on this test by Alexander Naumann and others, who came up with a psychometric model for indicators of instructional sensitivity. So after all this methodological work has been finished, we can start looking at effects. One of the first papers looking at effects was published in Journal of Educational Research, and it showed that for formative assessment only, there was a significant effect on student learning on floating and thinking. So that was kind of disappointing. So the other two practices of what we expected to be adaptive education didn't work that nicely. But in terms of differential effects, the scaffolding also had a substantial term positive effect, that it reduced the gap between high and low language proficient students in terms of their science learning. So both formative assessment and scaffolding have the differential effects that you would expect from a adaptive teaching practice. And this was, of course, a very important finding. We also then, at first, we independently looked at effects of our quality dimensions. In this case, for most of the first papers, we actually used the student ratings of teaching quality. We saw that all three of them do have an effect on teaching outcomes on student learning. There's a slight difference, as expected, classroom management and supportive climate in this case. As I've told you, they are not easily to disentangle. They both are relevant for student conceptual learning. There are also differential effects of the quality domains, especially with regard to classroom management and social climate. So these two aspects of teaching quality help to reduce the gap that is explained by migration background and also language factors. So there's, as expected from adaptive treatments, there's a differential effectiveness in terms of supporting disadvantaged children by these quality dimensions. And there's also a differential effect of all three quality dimensions with regard to classroom background factors. So in the paper before, we looked at differential effectiveness on the student level, finding that students with some individual kind of disadvantage were catered for by these teaching methods. And here we looked at the moderation of teaching effectiveness or teaching quality by a classroom variable, namely classroom heterogeneity, which is the standard deviation of either cognitive abilities or intelligence measured at the outset of the study, or the classroom standard deviation of reading comprehension at the beginning of the study. And we were able to prove that, and I think this is an important also message also from a practical point of view, these quality dimensions are related to a reduction in, or are especially effective for more heterogeneous classrooms. And something that is very important from a theoretical point of view when looking at the relationship between practices and quality dimensions, and I mentioned this before when I discussed the TIMSS video study, and I told you that we even didn't dare to ask these questions. In Eagle, we started asking the question, how is a discrete teaching practice, in this case it's formative assessment, which is the strongest adaptive teaching practices we have found in our study, how is this related to the basic dimensions, the generic dimensions of teaching quality? And in fact, not for classroom management, but for cognitive activation and for supportive climate, we see a nice positive interaction in the way that in the experimental group that used embedded formative assessment, these short diagnostic tests that were given to students, they were especially relevant in classrooms which have high process quality. So there's a positive interaction between the treatment, which is implementing a discrete practice like formative assessment on one hand, and the generic teaching quality on the other hand. Both make for a difference, and if you combine high generic quality with a proven effective practice like formative assessment, you get some extra benefit for student learning. Now moving to the usage part of the model and the mediation part, in a very recent paper by De Christan, Faud and others, which has been accepted for Search for Pädagogische Psychologie, they did a very laborious additional piece of empirical work, namely they identified individual students in the videos, and they were able to identify those students who were active because they themselves decided to be active. They were those students who were asked by the teacher or called upon by the teachers to participate, and there were those students who were called by the teacher because they had shown up and told by raising the hands that they would contribute anything. In this latter case, participation does not have an added value, but in the former two cases, there is a positive effect of student participation, active participation on their learning. So the use of instructional opportunities is relevant in addition to the quality and the practices and the content that is offered by the teachers. We also looked at student motivation, and in this case, Lena Hondrich came up with a very sophisticated mediation model which is similar to a mediation model we found in a COCA study, namely claiming that the effect of formative assessment on student motivation is mediated by perceived competence, which is predicted by the self-determination theory. Another more sophisticated look was at the effect of quality, teaching quality on student-reported use of metacognitive strategies, a dissertation by Svenja Riesa, and she was able to show that cognitive activation has a positive effect on student self-reported use of metacognitive strategies, and it reduces the relevance of general motivation for metacognition. So this is, once again, an adaptive kind of effect. We are seeing that the higher the level of cognitive activation, the less dependent is student metacognitive activity from their motivation, which I think is nice. By the way, in this study and in the ones that follow, quality was measured by observers. In this case, this was needed because her dependent variable, the use of metacognitive strategies, was assessed through student questionnaires. So if we would have assessed the quality also through student questionnaires, that would have been a trivial relationship. But using observers to judge the generic quality, it's a significant finding to see that teaching quality judged by independent observers does have an effect on student metacognition. And this is, I'm getting closer to the final, which is number 11. This one is also based on work by Svenja Riesa, and it shows that, to our surprise, there also was an effect of supportive climate on use of metacognitive strategies, and we wondered why supportive climate, why socio-emotional factors would have an effect on student cognition, or in this case even metacognition, and she was able to explain that all of this is mediated through intrinsic motivation. So the surprising effect of supportive climate on metacognitive use is in fact an effect which makes sense on intrinsic motivation, and as I already said, the link between motivation and metacognition is something that you see, that we find, what we don't like, and that's why we were, it was a nice result that we saw cognitive activation can help to reduce this kind of dependency. Last but not least, another paper which has just been accepted for publication in teaching and teacher education, also with Benjamin Faud as the first author. And this provides the full picture because finally, by reanalyzing the teacher data we had, we were able to identify an indicator of pedagogical content knowledge, self-efficacy, and teacher enthusiasm. Once again, observations were used to identify the teaching quality dimensions, especially cognitive activation. As I said, cognitive activation doesn't have significant alignment between student teachers and observers, and that's exactly where we need observers to come up with valid judgments on this aspect of quality. And the effect of the three quality dimensions on both student achievement and student interest are exactly as hypothesized in the TBD model, in the mediation model I showed earlier. And the relevance of teacher factors is sometimes surprising, like why should PCK especially have an impact on supportive climate? In general, at least, this shows that there is this link between teacher variables, teaching quality, and student learning. which of course has been studied and very broadly published by the coactive study directed by Mareike Kunter and Jürgen Baumert. So far for the Eagle study, and I think I will use some minutes to very briefly refer to OTL, or to the content aspect of teaching, and then show you the latest results on Tim's and Leibniz's video. Regarding content, there's an interesting, a very important aspect of Eagle that I realized why we were in the midst of this study. That is, this study would be by no way able to show any effect of content matter, because this was scripted instruction. The content matter was fully defined by the researchers. We even told teachers what kind of materials they would use, what kind of tasks they would give to the students, etc. So content matter was very highly controlled for, which, to my understanding, increased the internal validity and helped us to see impact of both practice and quality. But having realized that this is a pitfall of that kind of design, I started again thinking of the role of content matter and quality, which has been so prominent in earlier research. For example, Lee Shulman, 1986, said the content and the purpose for which it is taught are the very heart of the teaching-learning process. Shevelson and co-authors in the same edition of the handbook claimed that it would be important to bring the curriculum into the study of teaching, and they were referring to the early work by Bill Schmidt, who later was a key author, became a key author on issues of opportunity to learn, and more recently, there's this nice book by Jaap Skerens and Hans Leuten from our community. So it is an aspect that I think more recently has gained attention again, rightly so. And how can we deal with this? Obviously, the single topic content, focus content, kind of design we implemented in Eagle is not able to tell us anything about content, so we need a broader kind of design, and maybe the most, the broadest kind of study I can think of is the PISA study, and in fact in PISA 2012, when DIPF was responsible for the framework development, we were able, in collaboration with people at ETS and also Bill Schmidt was on the expert group, to implement some indicators of opportunity to learn or content covered in the student questionnaire. And this is a nice little indicator which nevertheless has an important can tell us important stories. And here students are asked about their experience with school algebra. So these are typical school algebra problems, linear equations, quadratic equations. And this is, if you look at this from a math didactics point of view, the school algebra is more or less the very heart of challenging mathematics within schools. And it turns out that this is quite relevant, at least in some countries. This is a correlation between experience in school algebra and achievement in mathematics. The correlation is quite high in tracked systems, like the systems around us here in Germany, in Belgium, and in the Netherlands, up to 26% in the Netherlands of student achievement variance can be explained by this little questionnaire scale on experience with school algebra. So this is something that does have a strong relationship with student achievement, and we have to take care of it. Also within PISA, nevertheless, we can see that in a country like Denmark, there's a zero correlation between exposure to algebra and student achievement. Maybe this is because Denmark is a good example for a country that is highly comprehensive and in its teaching, and has a, and also includes a lot of adaptive kind of approaches. So maybe the school structure, but also the teaching culture in Denmark is able to reduce this kind of relationship. Even stronger is the relationship, by the way, on the country level. So you can explain 17% of between country differences in PISA assessment by these three items. That's very close to what student background can explain. Once we were able to implement this in PISA, of course we thought we would have to move beyond cross-sectional studies. And one opportunity we had was that in Germany, PISA 2012 was enhanced by a follow-up study 1 year later, where classes, in integral classes who had participated in a German enhancement at ninth grade, also participated in a follow-up test 1 year later. And Susanne Kuger looked at this using the doubly latent model developed by Lütke Marsch and colleagues, and the interesting finding was that the effect of algebra, which is exactly this three-item scale, on student achievement 1 year later, when controlling for mathematics achievement in ninth grade, was twice the size of the effect of classroom management. So in this study, which is, I think, one of the few studies that use a longitudinal, multi-level kind of design, there's a strong argument in favor of content matter, the kind of content matter that students can see on their learning and on their achievement. So this is maybe let's take this as a suggestion to all of you. Don't forget the content matter. Don't forget opportunity to learn, which seems to be an old-fashioned kind of construct, but it is highly relevant. And the challenge for us as researchers is, I think, to find a kind of design that combines research on practices, quality, and content matter. Now, finally, the epilogue. Tim's video revisited. Revisiting Tim's video was a goal of the so-called Leibniz video study we started 2 years ago in Germany. This study is implemented in combination with Thales video, and Germany also participated in the Thales video study, but it's fully independent. It's a separate set of data, seven set of research questions, etc. And the goal of this national study is to compare teaching 2018 with teaching 23 years ago in Tim's video. So what we did was we sampled as many teachers as we were able to convince to participate in Germany, which unfortunately were only 44 teachers. It's a big problem of classroom teaching research we are facing in Germany right now. We would have loved to have a bigger sample, but so we have this sample of volunteering teachers, and we wanted to compare with the Teams video sample, which was kind of representative at that time, not enough Hauptschule at that time already. So what we were able to do with these 44 classrooms is they somehow, with regard to school type and region, we are only looking at West Germany here, to the classrooms that were assessed 23 years ago. Once again, we have just one video and we have any topic, which is much different from all the other studies you've seen before, including the Thales video, which is focused on quadratic equations. Trained raters applied codes, in this case for the six domains that are now in our model of teaching quality. And please keep this in mind, the sample in 2018 is by no way representative, and also now we are working with ninth grade, while before we had eighth grade. Nevertheless, the idea was it would be informative to see the pattern of changes between these two these two cohorts. And in effect, I found one citation by Nuthall and Snow from 1973, where they were more or less through anecdotal citations, they were able to address this issue of long-term changes in teaching, and they said that records of observational studies from the turn of the 19th century indicate that the game, they call this the game of teacher-student interaction in classroom, whole class discourse, has not changed substantially in approximately 60 years. So that's quite a pessimistic view, and this view can be supported theoretically by a type of theory that is well known in sociology of schooling, namely the idea that there's something like a grammar of schooling, and this grammar is very much built into schools and classrooms and teachers and students everywhere in all places and in all times. And based on this theory, we would expect very little change. Nevertheless, there's some research and theorizing saying that schools may have become more egalitarian. Fendt talks about humanization of school culture, and in fact he has shown through a nice creative empirical design that there are there are findings. He compared students he had assessed 40 years ago with their children who are now in school, and through this nice design he was able to show that there's some kind of more egalitarian teacher-student relationship. Also, in a paper I wrote with Moika Rossmann using TIMSS data, we were able to show that there's very little change in student-reported teaching practices as they report in TIMSS. But for one thing, there's something like a global trend. This is a trend towards more cooperative learning, at least between 95 and 2000. Based on what we have done and observed in Germany, we would of course like and maybe expect that, that we would now find more demanding content and cognitive activation, because there has been so much investment into teacher training, curricular reforms, etc., etc., especially in mathematics. And there's some data from PISA which shows that, as Fendt has also hypothesized, there's an increase improvement in teacher-student relationship, but also a decrease in student-reported disciplinary climate. So these are the hypotheses, many hypotheses. We were not very clear on what to see. We were interested in seeing a pattern. And first we look at the practices, especially the small group versus whole group practices. And this is the data for the 44 classes from TIMSS. So this is TIMSS video again, as you can see here. And the frequency of implementing each of these four settings has been judged on a four-point scale by the raters. So the value for whole group is very high, and small group pairs, individuals, are very seldom events, or have been very seldom events at that time. This is a replication of what I showed you before in the beginning of this talk. Now, these are the data from the current, from the Leibniz video study. You see a significant reduction in whole group teaching, and also a significant increase in pair working in pairs, and a tendency also to increase small group work. So the practices, or the social settings of teaching, actually have change, if we believe in this comparison, of course. Now, more important is the quality, and let me start the quality section with just one example, where you also can see the huge change, compare this to the previous video, the huge change in practices.
Wie weit seid ihr?
Okay, unfortunately, it's not loud enough, but I think from the other titles, you could already guess that this is really a much different kind of teaching. This is group work. Students are seated in groups. The teacher establishes a dialogue with them, asking about the solution process. The atmosphere is very calm, very friendly. The teacher even turns down, and so this is on an equal a level of equity between the teacher and the students. But still, she's doing what our first example teacher did. She's telling them what is right or wrong. This is wrong. You have to redo it, etc. So it's a kind of, from my perspective, and now I'm talking on from, let's say, a kind of practice theory perspective. This is a new practice of implementing discourse in German classrooms, which is a mix of the classical teacher-directed approach. Still, the teacher is directing, she is asking, she is commenting, she is telling students what is right or wrong and where they have to redo something. But it's a mix with what we have seen before in the Japanese videos, where the teacher is interested in seeing student work and reacting to that. So it's a new practice, which is a kind of amalgam between the traditional German teacher-directed kind of practice and what we've seen in Japan and what we've been told again and again by reform pedagogics would be good instruction. What do we see with regard to teaching quality? This is again the result for TIMSS, and the nice thing with the codes as they have been developed by Courtney Bell is that these are supposed to be, criterion reference. That is the way they are set up, and this is different from the high inference rating that Martin Clausen developed 20 years ago. The way they are set up is there's a clear maximum which is defined by examples, by video clips that the raters are shown. They are trained to identify, let's say, absolute levels of teaching quality. So whether it's a 4 or a 3 does make a difference with regard to the maximum that is supposed to exist on this domain. And so this is why this sequence here is so already a nice story. So classroom management was very high, but there was substantive variation. There were very bad classroom management examples back in 1995. Social emotional support, assessment and response to student understanding, so and so. And the three aspects that are most closely related to content matter, discourse, quality of subject matter, and student cognitive engagement, were rated relatively low. But the same hierarchy more or less holds now in Leibniz. But there's a significant increase, maybe you cannot see it from the box plot, but this is the strongest change in socio-emotional support. So in 2018, our raters see more social-emotional support in classrooms. There's also a significant change in assessment of and response to student understanding and in discourse. There's no change in means for classroom management, but there's a significant change in variation, meaning there are no longer these very bad examples. And there's no change in terms of quality of subject matter and student cognitive engagement. So what does this tell us? It tells us, in terms of practices, we now see less whole group work, there's less teacher-directed teaching, there's more support, there's better teacher-student interaction, including, by the way, content-related interaction, because discourse, especially discourse, and also assessment response to student understanding, these are domains that include the interaction with regard to content. But there's less change in content quality and cognitive engagement per se. So those domains that are not dealing with interactive aspects of teaching do not show difference. And this is what, whatever the representativity of these samples may tell you, this pattern, so there's some change here and there's no change there. This pattern, I think, does tell us a story. And this relates to the theoretical concept I told you before. So there seems to be some change in dimensions that are related to support and or teacher-student interaction, but there's no change or less change in content or subject matter didactics. At least this is what we see firsthand. These are very, very recent data. And the hypothesis here is the long-term change in West Germany teaching culture is mainly visible in interactive processes, including those that deal with content matter, and perhaps there's a change in both in relationships as hypothesized by Helmut Fendt, as shown in previous PISA data, together with a change in discourse-oriented didactics, as shown by Horstmann and myself before. So I think that's a pretty this is at least not a sad story, it's a pretty nice message, so there is change. Nathalie was not right that the game is the same over decades. I would love to see similar results from other countries. I think this is a rare example where we are able to actually do this kind of comparison. And I would like to end this journey by once again thanking all the colleagues, contributors who have been working with me. And it's a pleasure to work on those projects, and I thank you for your attention. Thank you.
So, thank you so much for all the insight in theory and research, massive core of results and perspectives for research, so there's a lot of to do, and it's very impressive to see all the people you took care of in their career, really. It's thank you so much. We're running a bit out of time, but probably there is time for one or two questions, if you have a remark, an urgent one you would like to pose to Eckhard Klima. It's a hand. Okay, yeah?
Yes, one. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thanks. I'm sorry for not leaving more time for discussion, but okay. I'm happy, by the way, to receive your suggestions, questions, whatever, through email. So here's my email, klima@dipf.de. Please feel free to approach me.
Can you shortly explain what you concretely mean by the concept of classroom management? Because there are different forms, sometimes like the new form, the inclusive form, or the traditional form.
Yeah, you're correct. And this is, I mean, the direct answer is that in many cases we do measure classroom management indirectly through a scale that talks about classroom disciplinary climate. So are there any disturbances in classroom? If there's no disturbance, the assumption is classroom management is working well, but this is, of course, an indirect assessment. For example, in the PISA studies and in most questionnaire studies, this is a way to operationalize classroom management. But, of course, there are more direct ways, for example, looking at how exactly how the teacher manages turns within a classroom, within a lesson, how he responds to disturbances by students, etc. And there, I know there's a lot of theory, and maybe I also can make one remark here. You could take any aspect of teaching quality and turn this into a holistic theory of teaching quality. And especially with classroom management, that has done. There has been a lot of work on classroom management, for example, by Felicitas Steele in Germany and others. And Tina Seidel has been writing on it as well and others. And if you, the deeper you dig into the theoretical understanding and operationalization of classroom management, the more you will find out that this actually incorporates student report and incorporates clarity and incorporates even some kind of cognitive activation. But in a similar way, you could claim that highly supportive classrooms also need classroom management and cognitive activation. So the distinction between these factors is a very delicate one. And I'm aware of the fact that the deeper you dig into classroom management, the more facets it has, but the consequence will be the more difficult it is to disentangle this from other dimensions.
Okay, and then the focus lays on interruptions.
Yeah.
Yeah. You say it is a traditional form of classroom management. I understand right?
I mean, in the theory of Kunin, which you will be aware of, the idea is that the good teacher who has a lot of withness is able to monitor the classroom and prevent disruptions before they even occur. So this kind of preventive activity monitoring is at the very heart of classroom management, of course.
Yeah. Okay, we have to leave the rest of the discussion for the coffee break. It's now time to thank you very, very much for your inspiring keynote. A little present from the region. The
thank
organizers
you.
Handed it over to me, so I'm happy to hand it over to you. So thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Danke. Danke.
Have a good time.